Assistant of Rich Baba Church, name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's great to have you here tonight. Give everybody a chance to get seated. We've got plenty of rows here. Hi, everybody who's ever listening out there. Welcome. Give you a chance to get on. Got an exciting message for tonight. Going to have a song to open up with, and then we're going to close with the song. But let me just go through our information for tonight. Again, this is Center Reach Bible Church, Center Reach, New York. We're just so happy that we can continue bringing out the true, untouched, untarnished Word of God, uncorruptible, uncorrupted, to you as much as we can. And just for a reminder, don't forget Tuesday night, every Tuesday night, very interesting thing we do. We'll be live again on Facebook. It's Life Talk, 7 o'clock p.m. And that's an opportunity for you to send in questions on Facebook, which we will answer as we go. Any question about anything. If you'd like to send in a question and you'd like to not have your name known, you can text us. We have a special text-only number, 631-769-6712. Should be on the Facebook page, 631-769-6712. Wednesday night, we'll have a Bible study that'll also be live, 7:30 p.m. Wednesday night, the Book of Jude. That'll be part three, the elephant in the room. Are we living in the last days before Christ's return, or are we not? Also, we are doing phone counseling, and the days are getting filled up. We're spending the whole day on Thursday for counseling, one-hour sessions. Just call the office to make an appointment, 631-732-3283. And for those who are giving to the church online, I know some people have had some problems and just you need to work through it. If you want to mark where you want that certain amount of money to go on the application, you'll see a little icon of a pen or a pencil. Click on that and you can make a note, like a check note. Or you can mail in your offerings to Center Reach Bible Church, 170 North Coleman Road, Center Reach, New York, 11720. And also, before we begin, just a recommendation I've been recommending to everyone. You're sitting home, you don't know what to watch. There's a movie out called Before the Wrath. Great movie. It's $14, whatever it is. We've wasted money on silly things bigger than that before. God knows I have. Sit down, watch the movie Before the Wrath, it's called. Greatly done, very encouraging about our Lord rescuing his people from any trials or tribulations. So with that being said, we're going to go to a song. Please stand up. It's crucial that we worship our Lord together. That's what he desires. That's okay. We have a very small staff here tonight, running around doing many things at one time, so we excuse our segues. Anyway, tonight, we want you to turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 21. Tonight's going to be a very interesting study, a little speculative, something for you to make a decision on and see what you think. 2 Chronicles 6:21. Hearken therefore unto the supplications of thy servant and of thy people Israel, which they shall make toward this place. Hear thou from thy dwelling place, even from heaven, and when thou hearest, forgive. Let's bow our heads in the word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for tonight, Lord, and I know it's hard to be thankful in these times, but these are the times that you want us to be thankful in, Father. We thank you for even this trial that is really drawing us close to you. It's testing our faith and to see what we really truly depend on. Do we really depend on you? This is really putting the rubber to the road here. Father, also I ask for prayers for those who are not feeling well. I pray for a certain sister in Christ who has a fever. We pray that that fever would break. And even as the Lord Jesus Christ said to that soldier who came with his child who had a fever, and the Lord said, your child is healed at this very time, Father. We pray, Father, that you would heal that child of ours and anyone else there who is dealing with this sickness, any sickness, cancer, all the different things, Father. But more importantly, that we get right with you, Lord. Bless this message tonight. Give the winds a mighty voice. And let us open up your word and contemplate its possibilities. In Jesus' name, amen. So tonight, the title is, Can This, when I say this whole crazy COVID thing going on, this virus thing, could it be over that easy? And it's really a simple question that I'm going to ask tonight, and it's going to be a simple black and white answer, as in, is there anything that we can do to change the tide of this roaring monster, this roaring, raging river going through our world, our nations, our towns, our homes? It's like the juggernaut running down a cliff, a steamroller out of control with so much momentum and power and weight that no one dare stand in front of it lest they be rolled over by it. Well, tonight I'm going to throw you out some possibilities, and I want you to contemplate them and think upon them. Because according to God's character, according to God's promises, and according to God's words, well, I believe that we actually can do something about all this that's going on. But the question is, and God already knows the answer, will we? Okay? Meaning, I truly believe if, according to God's word, which I'm going to prove to you tonight, if we did obey the word of the Lord as his word is commanded, hypothetically, we can stay this whole thing. Imagine that. Imagine what would happen if tomorrow we did what we were supposed to do and everything started to just fall down and go back to normal. And I tell you people, what we would do if everything did go back to normal will determine if God will ever allow it to go back to normal. See, that's the conundrum, that's the paradox here. But before we go into this speculative question here, as what could we do to change the tide, let's discuss first God and who he is to build my case here, okay? Number one, and last Sunday we spoke about this. Number one, the character of God is he is immutable, and I've spent a lot of time on that. Hebrews 6:18, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. God has laid a hope before us, but if we don't run to the life preserver, it can't save us. So what does this mean about the immutability of God? Well, it says that God is the same all the time. Whatever he says one place, he means it there, whether he said it in the past, in the present, or in the future. To some degree, those promises, unless they be specific promises like to Israel, to whatever, but for the most part, God is immutable. Well, not most part, he is immutable. Whatever he says stays the same. Number two, God never changes. And you might say, well, isn't that the same as his immutability? Well, it's kind of opening up that word immutability a little bit more and digging deeper. In Malachi 3:6, we get to hear God speak, and God says, "For I am the Lord." He says, "I am Yahweh, I am the I am. I change not. Therefore, my sons Israel are not consumed." My sons of Israel are not consumed. Psalm 131:3. "Let Israel hope in the Lord from henceforth and forevermore." Hebrews 13:8. "Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever." Interesting, the forever. Point number three about the character of God. God is merciful. He is always merciful. In 1 Chronicles 16:34, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good." Does God ever stop being good? No. It's part of his character. He can't be bad. He's not bad. He is good in whatever thing he does. "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, Yahweh God, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." Yes or no? Is that scripture true? Can we give thanks to the Lord? Is the Lord good? Is his mercy always there? Does it endure forever? Yes. 2 Chronicles 7:3. "And when all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of God upon the house, they bowed themselves in their faces to the ground unto the pavement and worshipped and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good. His mercy endures forever." Point number four of God's immutability, of his character, which I'm building, it's like when you're building a case for something, if you're a lawyer and you're trying to defend your client, you build the case to persuade, not by deceit, but to persuade by facts, the people who are in the jury to see what is the true thing. So I am building like a house. I'm putting down the foundation, and then you decide if what I put on top of that foundation, what we put on top of it, will the foundation hold it? So number four, the next question, does God wait for us to move sometimes? Does God wait for his people to act before he acts? Well, Psalm 33:18, "Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him." He watches us. "Upon them that hope in his mercy, to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in famine." Okay, God is looking at those who hope in his mercy to deliver them. Jeremiah 18:8. "If that nation," now this is interesting, not just speaking about Israel, it's speaking about any nation, the prophet Jeremiah, "if that nation against whom I have pronounced turn from their evil, I will repent of the evil that I brought to do unto them." Always remember, God doesn't bring evil. Remember, by God pulling away, evil comes in. And so it's kind of like a little play on words there. "And at what instant I shall speak concerning a nation, any nation, and concerning a kingdom, any kingdom, to build and to plant it. If it do evil in my sight, that it obey not my voice, then I will repent of the good wherewith I said I would benefit them." Remember, God builds up nations. He does good to nations. We know of the United States, the only nation built on God itself, I mean, barring Israel. You know, we were, you know, in case you don't know it, the founding fathers of this nation built this on God. It was a Christ, no matter what you look at it, you look back at the history, it is a nation built on the Bible and Christ, which is why we say one nation under God. It's on our money. And that God is Yahweh God, the Hebrew God, the Christian God, Yahweh God, the great I am. And what was the result? The nation that pleases God will be blessed by God. And what has happened to the United States? We have become one of the greatest, we are the greatest superpower in history. In history. But we have to ask ourselves, who brought us there? Our own good deeds, our own merit, or did God, because of our faith in Him? So it's clear here that God says He can take a nation down who disobeys them. He could build a nation up who does obey Him. Point five, the question, can we ask God to have mercy on us, and will He? Well, Psalm 25:16 says, "Turn unto me and have mercy unto me, for I am afraid and I am destitute and afflicted. The troubles of my heart have enlarged me." Now, this is the psalmist speaking. "Oh, bring thou me out of distress." Isn't that something that we want? We want God to take us out of this distress. "Look upon my affliction and my pain, and forgive all my sins. Consider my enemies, for they are many that hate me with cruel hatred. Oh, keep my soul and deliver me, and let me not be ashamed, for I put my trust in thee." See, what if we are ashamed of God? Okay? Some of us are. "Let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait on thee. Redeem Israel, O God, out of all of his troubles." Psalm 34:6 says, "This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him." So this is an important case. We see a scenario here. Okay, you know, it's a metaphoric application here, but it's a situational lesson. "This poor man cried, the Lord heard." When we cry, the Lord hears. "And he saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him and delivered them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him." Point number six, question number six. Can God be moved by man's heart to stop the judgment that he has on a wicked people? And people, you have to understand, God does judge the nations. Does it make him a bad God? Do we complain to the police or the judge in the courtroom when he says guilty for a crime? No, that's just the law. He pronounces the judgment. When a people, a person, a nation, a kingdom goes astray against God's law, God pronounces a correction. He gives them a penalty. As a good parent, we don't reward our children when they do bad. Put them in their room, lock them in, whatever, you know, tell them no games, whatever. There is a consequence. See, if there's no consequence for law breaking, there will be lawlessness. We know this in our legal system, that when the legal system starts to let everyone out and we don't follow the laws that are on the book, people will say, "Hey, there's no consequence for my sin, for my breaking this law. I will break it over and over again." And what happens to a society when the criminals know that there is no consequences? They are going to do more crimes. Okay? If you let a criminal go who has done a crime, he's not going to be good. He's going to be worse because he knows there's no consequences. So we need to understand, God does correct a nation. Okay? But can God's heart be moved by a nation in repentance? Well, in the book of Genesis, chapter 18, verse 20, "And the Lord said," this is an important account, and I listen to this well. "And the Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous." So this is a real place, probably takes place, I think, in Iraq. There is a city, and just gone down the tubes, okay? And there is, you know, a godly family living there, okay? "And God hears the cries of the sin. He feels the evilness towards anything that's good. And God says, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which is to come unto me. And if not, I will know. God knows the hearts. We can say, we're a great God. I mean, we're a great nation. We're a great people. I'm a great person. I've never done anything wrong. God says, let me check the heart. I know. Because it's not even just what we do. It's what we think. God knows. So God will investigate. Verse 22, and the men turned their faces from thence and went toward Sodom. So God sent angels to this city to do like a little bit of reporting, to observe and report back to God. But Abraham stood before the Lord. Now this is interesting. Now we have the man of God, Abraham. We spoke about this morning. He knows that the city is really bad. It's gone into complete perversion. It's just horrible. God is sending down those to check it out. Not that God doesn't know, but in this case, he's using this so we can see metaphorically how clear, so we can't say, well, God, how could you know? He knows. But Abraham, the man of God, sees this happening. He knows that this place is bad, and he intercedes. Let's see what happens. And Abraham drew near and said, will thou also destroy the righteous with the wicked? You see, Abraham says to these men, actually speaking to God is who he's really speaking to. He's going, listen, I know there's bad things going on here, okay, in our family, in our nation, in our world, but this specific city. And Abraham says to God, will you destroy the whole nation, the whole city? If there's a couple of good people left, righteous, God-fearing people, and he gives God this mathematical equation. He says, peradventure, because hypothetically, God, say if there be like 50 righteous people in the city, will you destroy and not spare the place for 50 righteous people? That be far from thee to do after this matter, to slay the righteous and the wicked, and that the righteous should be as the wicked. That be far from thee. Shall not the judge of the earth do right? So Abraham being a little cocky here, said, hey God, you're the righteous God. Are you going to punish the good people with the bad, the believers from the unbelievers? And listen to what the Lord says. Now this account is really long. I'm not going to do the whole thing. Verse 26, and the Lord said, if I find in Sodom 50 righteous people within the city, I will spare all the place for their sakes. And the account goes on, and Abraham goes, well, how about 40 people? How about 20 people? How about one person, God? If there's one person who loves you and follows you, will you spare it? And God says, for one person, I will spare it. So what's the point that I'm trying to say here is, well, and this is what I want you to chew on tonight. Maybe, let's think of this, maybe we could do something as a people to change the tide, to maybe move God's heart, to either stop Satan's plan or stop what God is allowing, whatever forces are behind it. But I know some of you are saying, yeah, but Pastor, you know, you're always talking about we're living in the last days and the rapture is coming soon, and that's very exciting, and I want it, and people, believe me, take me home anytime, I'm fine. The Lord is returning, but this is the problem. When we start to say, and you know what? The world needs to get what's coming to them. Now, we have to be careful when we say that, when we start to think like that. Because I want to ask you a question. We must be very careful when we begin to think like that. Now, you remember there was a prophet, okay, who was sent to a city called Nineveh. And I know who you know I'm talking about. And what did that prophet want? Well, originally God sent this man to this city to judge, because God was going to judge the city. They also fell into sin, and he sent a prophet and to tell them to repent, to change, so he could spare the city. But what happened? The man who was sent there, look it up, you guys should know this, he tells people to repent, confess their sins, get right to God. And you know what happens? What happens? They do. They turn away from the way their wicked city is going, and God spares the judgment. Now listen to me here. I am not saying that we can stop God's return or whatever he has planned, nor would I want to do that. But we also have to ask ourselves, where is our mercy? Because I tell you, today I was really thinking about this. I've been convicted because by God, the Holy Spirit, I know I see all this going on. I'm saying, Lord, just come and just get us out of here. This is just horrible. But then I think, what about everyone who's left who still hasn't heard the gospel? Okay? Now listen, if there is one person left that God is waiting for them to come to Christ and repent, should we not ask God to hold back so that one person can come to Christ? Doesn't mean God has to, but should we not even care about that person? Don't we have family members? Or we're saying, I'm out of here. I give up. God, I have no more mercy for these people. Yet God has had mercy on us. And I know it's a fine line here, because we're supposed to even hasten the Lord's return. We're supposed to look for his return, and we should be looking for his return, but not forgetting God's mercy and his desire. What's God's desire? That all would be saved. And, you know, I joke around a lot. Well, I joke around, it's in the scriptures. But what makes heaven rejoice? One sinner that repents. Every time one person confesses their sin to God and comes to Christ and becomes a Christian, the Bible says the angels in heaven rejoice. That's the only thing that they rejoice about. Shouldn't we rejoice about the same thing? But anyway, I want to get back to this speculation, okay? Because this is a hypothetical question that I don't know the answer to, but I want you to think about it. As to, number one, how do we know the rapture really is near? What if it's 10 years off? Yeah, I hope not. But what if it is? And what if God is saying, you know, people, though the end must come, and it must because God is a promise keeper, yet if I see mercy and repentance and can hold off that day, I will, as he did in Sodom and as he did in Nineveh. Which brings us back to my question. A, if the Lord changes not, B, if he is still long-suffering, very patient, if God is still looking for people to repent, well, could he not then heal our land and give us another chance? How do we know that? Right? As God has healed, now keep in mind, Israel has been judged and healed over and over. You got a problem, Andrew? Good. Over and over again. And we have seen through God's working with Israel, that he is long-suffering. Yes, he does correct the nations, but he does forgive them. But the next question is, are we as long-suffering as God? And could we, if we did the right thing, move God? Well, here's the answer, and also why, and I know this is kind of an awkward statement. I think there is something we can do, but I don't think we will do it. Meaning, the wrath being held off, the judgment. Not because of God, but because of us. Because I don't know how much we want what we want. So anyway, check this out. This is what I'm going to, for the next half an hour here, I am not going to base this on this typical scripture that everyone uses, but I am going to read the scripture, but it's not the focal point, but it is part of it, okay? 2 Chronicles 7:14, everybody's throwing this scripture around right now, and you have to be careful because it is speaking to God's people, not so much the world, And it is speaking specifically to Israel, but it does say this, 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sins. Remember, forgiveness, sin is the issue before the sickness. I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. And then God says in verse 15, now my eyes shall be opened and my ears shall attend unto the prayer that is made in this place. Is anybody repenting down there? I'm looking. Anybody changing their way? They don't like what's happening. Are they willing to come to me worshiping on their knees, okay, and to move me to hold back the judgment? Meaning what? Well, God is listening and he is watching and he has done something over and over again. He has offered forgiveness and new beginnings. Forgiveness, new beginnings, over and over again. Yeah, I know there will be a time where the hammer comes and that'll be it. But we don't know 100% if this is the time, okay? Looks like it is, but we don't know. So what are we supposed to be doing? Well, let's go to 2 Chronicles. This is going to be my scripture for the night. It's going to be a long read here, but it's important. I was going to cut out a lot, but it's important that I read all of this. Again, let's speculation here. 2 Chronicles 6:21 through 33. Now this is Solomon. David has died. Solomon the son has taken over as king of Israel, and he built the temple and he's doing the dedication ceremony. And here it goes. And this is going to be New Living Translation. Verse 12. Then Solomon stood with his hands spread out before the altar of the Lord in front of the entire community of Israel. Verse 14, and he prayed, O Lord God of Israel, there is no one like you in all of heaven and earth. You keep your promises and you show unfailing love to all who obey and are eager to do your will. That's the problem. How eager are we really to do his will? You have kept your promises to your servant David, my father. You have made that promise with your own mouth, and today you have fulfilled it with your own hands. And now, O Lord, God of Israel, carry out your further promise to your servant David, my father. For you said to him, if your descendants guard their behavior and obey my laws as you have done, they will always reign over Israel. But Solomon makes this interesting plea to God. Verse 24. If your people Israel, he's talking to God, says, God, your people Israel, if they are defeated by their enemies because they have sinned against you, and if they turn to you and call on your name and pray to you, here is this temple, then hear from heaven and forgive their sins and return to them this land you gave their ancestors. So Solomon's, you know, is kind of doing like a preemptive prayer because he knows God's people, Israel. He knows what he has to rule over. And he's already saying, God, you know, I'm going to rule this people. But if they get bad and they turn from you and they do bad stuff and we start to fall, if they say they're sorry, will you lift us up again? So Solomon is just testing the waters of what God will do because Solomon knows what type of a people he has to deal with. And he says in verse 25, then hear from heaven and forgive their sins and return them to this land you gave their ancestors. Verse 26, if the skies are shut up and there is no rain because your people have sinned against you, and then they pray towards this temple and confess your name and turn from their sins because you have punished them, then hear from heaven, forgive their sins of your servants, your people Israel. Teach them to do what is right and send rain on your land, that the people land that you have given to your people as their special possession. Verse 28, now this is an important verse here. If there is a famine in the land, if there is a plague of sickness in the land, if there is diseases that destroy their crops, if there are attack of locusts and caterpillars, or if your people's enemies come and take over or come into the land, besieging their towns, whatever the trouble is, God, and he's asking the question, now if your people offer prayer concerning their trouble and sorrow, raising their hands in this temple, what will you do? Verse 30, Solomon continues this plea. Hear then from heaven where you live and forgive. God, your people, whatever they deserve, for you alone know the human heart. If they deserve the judgment, I understand. But if they really repent, God, forgive them. And Solomon is trusting in the character of God that he knows. He knows God's character. Verse 31, then they will fear you and walk in your ways as long as they live in the land you gave their ancestors. And when foreigners hear of you and your mighty miracles, and they come from distant lands to worship your great name and to pray towards this temple, then hear from heaven where you live and grant what they ask of you, that all the people of the earth will come to know and fear you, just as your own people Israel do. So Solomon's saying, you know, if the world sees that we did something wrong, we confess it, and then you help us and heal our land, other people are going to see how mighty you are, and other people are going to come to you because of your favor on this nation. So God, it's a good thing, right? Verse 35, then hear their prayers from heaven and uphold their cause. If they sin against you who has never sinned, you may become angry with them and let their enemies conquer them and take them captive to a foreign land, a foreign year. If they sin and they don't repent, then judge them, Lord. Do what you have to. But in that land of exile, they may turn to you again in repentance and pray that we have sinned, we have done evil, and we have acted wickedly. Then, if they turn to you with their whole heart and soul and pray towards the land you gave their ancestors, toward the city you have chosen, towards this temple I have built in honor of your name, then hear their prayers from heaven where you live. Uphold their cause, forgive your people who have sinned against you. Oh my God, be attentive to all the prayers made in this place. Now, I know that's a long scripture, but the reason why I read that is it's suggesting something here. And I am suggesting something here that if each nation on the planet right now, as we are also called as individuals to do the same thing. Let's just use the United States of America. What if tomorrow every single person on the planet, I think God would even take, even if every church, every Christian on the planet got on their knees, got into the streets of our cities, raised our hands to heaven, repented on what we have become and what we have done against you, changed our ways, worshiped God, that God could and he would save our nation. Could he? Would he? What if we did that? What if each nation on the planet had a global renewal, falling on our knees, admitting we have gone to the dark side, and we want forgiveness, we're going to change our ways, please heal our land, we believe that you are the only God, the one God, and we want to get back to your principles and back to holiness and righteousness. What would God do? Well, according to scriptures, I think God could stay the plague. He could hold it off. He's done it before. But the thing here is, and I don't want to be the one who brings you the downer, the question is, would we do that? Do you see that happening? And I'll tell you why I don't think it will happen. It would be great, I say, if everyone did that next week and we had a worldwide day of repentance and crying out to the one and only God, okay, for forgiveness. That would be great, but I tell you why I think it won't happen. Number one, because we are fools, okay? We are a foolish people, and we have a great account in Psalm 14:1 to the chief musician, a psalm of David. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Okay? There are too many people here who are blind to all that's going on. They do not see evilness. They do not see wickedness. They think whatever they want, they can touch and grab. They can run after their own desires of their flesh. There's no consequences. They'll curse your name, and they will not change. Reason number two why we won't. Acts 26:21. For these causes, the Jews caught me into the temple. And I have to do the backstory here to actually get the point I want to get to. For these causes, the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. Having therefore obtained help of God, I continued unto this day, witnessing both the small and great, saying none other things than those which the prophets of Moses did say to come, that Christ should come, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. Now, there's a child of God who's speaking to a political leader. And as he spake for himself, Festus, now this Festus is a political leader, said with a loud voice to the man of God. Who is the man of God? Well, I believe it's Paul. Some believe it could be Luke in Acts. Doesn't matter. But Paul, thou art beside thyself. Much learning has made you mad. Okay? What does that mean? Okay, now remember Paul, who was Saul, and let's just go with the Paul here. Remember, he didn't believe in Christ. He had a conversion experience. He came to Christ. He was once killing Christians, putting them in prison. He hated Christianity, anything to do with that. He met the living God, changed his ways, and he was a very learned man. Okay, very learned man. But this political person who has known him says, are you insane, Paul? Are you insane? Have you lost your mind? Where'd you get this nonsense from about Christ and repenting? And you know, it's just silliness. But he replies to Festus. But he said, I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak forth the words of truth and soberness. For the king knoweth these things. Festus, you should know these things if you know God's law, before whom I also speak freely. For I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him. For these things were not done in a corner. Then King Agrippa believeth. And he says, King Agrippa, believest not the prophets? I know that thou believest. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, and this is the part, and I know I really led up to this, took a long time. I really should have just read the scripture. But the account here is the man who didn't believe said, you almost persuaded me to be a Christian. That's verse 28 of Acts 26. You almost got me to believe. But the problem is, people, so many people, you can give them the truth, you can give them the gospel, and they might come close to accepting it and repenting and changing their ways, but their selfishness, their pride, their wisdom of the world will keep them from coming. So what's the good news and the bad news for tonight? Well, the good news is I believe we could move God's mind on this. We have scriptures to prove that God has been moved before to watch a people turn from their evil ways and heal their land. But the bad is, because most people of the world today, and especially this nation, okay, this nation, we are so dug in with our pride, our arrogance, our insanity, our false science in many cases, our personal love for pleasure more than any love for God at any cost, our love for this planet more than for the planet maker, in love with our sins, that I don't see Team CNN falling on their knees and repenting on air that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. I don't see MSNBC and NBC falling on their knees and professing to the nation, Jesus Christ is all Lord of Lord. I don't see Hollywood doing it, and I certainly don't see one political party falling on their knees and saying, we have sinned against the God of heaven. We will repent of our ways and follow you, Lord. I don't see it happening. Could happen? Well, anything is possible with God, right? We know it's possible, but I just don't think it's going to happen this time around. I fear, and this is an important point, people. I want you to think about something. I've been really thinking about this. Because this will determine what happens next. Let's just say, hypothetically, next week a cure comes out, a vaccine comes out, and in a week everything is back to normal. What do you think the world will do? Will everyone fall on their knees and thank God for a second chance? Or will they all go out to the clubs, to the bars? Parties will be lined in the street and people will be go right back to themselves, just using it as a chance to just party themselves back to where they were before. Now, if it did bring everybody, and I think there will be people who will thank God, I think we'll forget God pretty quickly. It's proven in history. The minute God delivers the people, we know in Israel, when God parted the Red Sea and they went to the other side, praise the Lord, that praise didn't last long. Because it wasn't long, they were cursing God again. You see, God gets blamed when everything goes wrong. He never gets praised when things go right. And God knows what we'll do. So he's watching. So if I just push this plague out of here, is everybody going to worship me and follow me and get back to where we're supposed to be? He knows the answer. I don't. He does. And if he knows, you're going to go right back to who you were before, the way we speak, the way we live, the way we talk, the way we curse God's name. If we're going to go right back to that, God's not going to stay this. He's not going to do it. One other note. There are some people, and this is a sad thing to me. There are some people, and you know it's true, that they would rather pull the plug on their own sinking ship than bow the knee to Christ. We know there are people in politics that they would rather die. They'd rather see people in our nation die than to admit they're wrong, to come to the truth and say, wow, we've been so wrong, we need to get back to God, God is the way. Unless things get really bad, I don't know how those people are going to be moved. They have hardened hearts, scales over their eyes. And boy, we can't even get people to admit they're wrong in church. I preach this, I've been preaching this for years. If you hurt someone's feelings or if you've done something wrong, go and apologize. There are people who will not apologize to another person, a Christian to a Christian, because of their pride. And do you think we're going to apologize to God? Our hearts will be the death knell in what happens next. Not God's plan, our plan. And remember this, it's not God who does evil. It's impossible for God to do evil. Okay? It's never God. It's mankind's decision to allow evil to take over a society. Okay? If you bring in drugs and stuff into your family, into your children, who's responsible, okay, for what happens to that family? The person who brings them in. We are responsible for what's going on. I want to read 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. Paul says to Timothy, you should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times, for people will love only themselves and their money. That's a problem that has to change. They will brag and they will be proud. They will scoff at God. They will be disobedient to their parents. They will be ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving, unforgiving, they will slander others, they will have no self-control, they will be cruel and have no interest in anything that is good. They will betray their friends, they will be reckless, they will be puffed up with pride and love pleasure more than they love God. God is describing what the world's going to be like in the future. That's today, people. They will act as if they are religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. You must stay away from people like that. Now, I want to close on a personal note here. Number one, though like Paul, I would rather be with the Lord, because we have this encounter where Paul talks about, you know what, if I had my choice, I would just rather be with God. But what does Paul say? Yet if God wants me to stay here longer and preach the word, then not my will, let God's will be done. You see, he chose to take the higher road, not because it was good for Paul, but it was good for God. And also point two, back to the question, nothing is impossible, and I'm not saying it's impossible to happen. Things could change. But how is it going to happen? You know where it starts? With us spreading the word. If you want to get a mass repentance done, if you want people to start repenting, well, what does the Bible say? The judgment begins at the house of God. It begins with us, all of us falling on our knees, the church, Christians, and confessing and getting right to God and making sure our heart is right with him. And then telling everyone else, you've got to repent. Now I'm going to give you a challenge that will prove my point that I bet many of us still won't do what God is calling us to do. Because what if God says, okay, I tell you people, you want this to be stayed? You want me to kick Satan in the tail and get him out of here with all this evil stuff? I want you to preach the gospel to every unsaved person you know. Tell them, because that's what you should be doing. And if you can't do that, I tell you what, with all your social media, take 2 Chronicles 7:14 and 15, copy and paste it, and text it and send it to every unsaved family member, co-worker, and people you know on Facebook. 2 Chronicles 14, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. And then verse 15, God's waiting, he's listening. But you know what? I bet you most of us won't. We'll say, well, I'm not going to send that to Uncle Joe because he's really going to get angry at me. I'm not going to send the gospel to my neighbor because they're going to think I'm crazy. And what does that mean? That we are not willing to do anything to please God. We're only willing to do what we feel is worth doing. And if we don't care about the rest of the world hearing the gospel, then that's a bad thing, people. Because we know what's coming. We know it gets worse. And if we won't even fall on our knees and repent and cry out to our God in this nation, how do we expect the rest of the world to follow suit? But the good news is, and I want to leave you on this good news, the good news is God's listening. He is listening, like he said in 2 Chronicles 7:15. My eyes are open. I'm watching the planet. Is anyone turning from their wicked ways? Is anyone repenting and saying, Lord, I've lived in wretched sin. I've perverted everything against nature and man. Is anyone going to do that? God says, I'm waiting. And just like he promised Abraham about Sodom, if there be one righteous person, I will spare the land. Think about it. What do you think about that? Okay? What do you think? Okay? Should we do that? Do you think it's possible? I know what's important. We are called to preach the gospel, right? Right to the end of the age. And I think a lot of this falls back on the church because we have dropped the ball of building our kingdom and forgetting about building God's kingdom and getting people to Christ. It became not that important anymore. And what was worse, we as Christians, we let our lives be so intertwined with the world that we look like the world, we dress like the world, we listen to what the world listens to, we do what the world does, and we are not even defined anymore other than by being people who judge everyone else when we are sin ourselves and needed to be judged. Something to think about. And you might say, well, where's the hope there? The hope there is that, you know what? God could change course. He could. But it's not his responsibility. It's our responsibility to repent. Will we do it? And if our nation doesn't and our town doesn't, whatever, I'm telling you, as I need to. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is the time. This is the moment. Okay? Because He will spare the judgment that is meant for you. He will. That's what the cross is all about. That's what resurrection is all about. Trust in Jesus Christ. Believe that He died on the cross and He rose again the third day for your sins. And He's coming back to rescue you from the trouble to come. Trust in Him. Let's bow our heads and then we're going to close with a worship song. Please don't leave yet. Father in heaven, Lord God, Lord, I don't know what the future holds, Lord. Only You know that. I don't know what You do. I can't make You do anything, Lord. But I know there are some things in the Scriptures that do say that You do listen, obviously, and You are moved by a true repentant heart, Lord. May, you know, I don't know what the world's going to do, Lord, but it would be great, Lord, if our nation, this once great United States of America, that they would fall to their knees and we would call out to the one true God and say, God, give us another chance. And I know, Father, if we did, You would, because that's Your character. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's go.
Jesus Christ, my living.
going to close in prayer right now. Hold on for a second. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, Lord, as I stand here tonight, Lord, to an empty church, I know there are those listening, Father, but I know there's still a part of me that knows this is not right, Lord. The saints need to gather together. We need to worship together, Father. And Father, may this plague pass, Father, that we can worship you again together, Lord. Because it's hard to preach to an empty building, Lord. And it breaks my heart dearly, Lord. It certainly does. And I know one thing for certain. We will meet again, your saints. And we will be together again, praising you. Whether it be in this facility and the churches across the land, or whether we meet each other again to worship you in glory. One way or another, we will be together again. And until that day, let us preach the gospel to the ends of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.